The other day, I read this article in a Dutch financial newspaper about this man who started a business to recruit highly educated IT talent and then deploy them at various companies. His first client was a big international company that needed 12 new IT employees. His job was to educate these 12 IT people before deploying them at the client's company. He already paid for teachers, designed a custom-made training program for these 12 IT students, paid for hotels, etc. But then everything fell apart when he received a phone call from that same client that the deal got cancelled. Because their client never signed the contract, there were no legal bindings to hold them accountable for the lost revenue and the cost. After doing hours of damage control by making phone calls days on end, he could minimize his total loss to 30,000 euros. And in my opinion, that total loss of 30,000 euros might not even be the worst part. The worst part was that he received a cancellation phone call from his client while he was on his first day of their family trip through Europe. He was together with his wife and two kids of 7 and 5 years of age. The newspaper article explained that this guy spent hours every day of their 10-day trip making calls to do damage control. It was literally a failed vacation. So the first thing that comes to my mind is that I don't understand he tries to build a business that can jeopardize his quality time with his family. Do you really want to be remembered by your daughter as the father who spent time calling all day, every day while on vacation? I don't want that to be me. Furthermore, at what age will a child stop going on vacation with their parents? At the age of 16, 18, 20? Let's say of the age of 18. After that age, they want to go on vacation with their friends or boyfriend or girlfriend. In other words, if you go on vacation one time per year, you can only build 13 vacation experiences with your child from 5 years of age to 18. Imagine you screwed up one of those 13 lifetime memories. So when I was reading this article for the first time, the first thought that came to my mind was, what a terrible business idea. For me, and that is how I see life, I want to make as many beautiful memories as possible with the people I love most. And I'm sure the heck I don't want some business-related content calling me while spending quality time with my family. If there's a family party or family trip or whatever else I can do to make beautiful memories, I will definitely be there. This is the number one reason why I built this online business that I currently have. Having the flexibility of time to do whatever I want, whenever I want, without the stress that a single client can jeopardize my happiness. I have a puppy training blog where I share tips about raising a puppy. I wrote and self-published 4 puppy training books and sell them online as an ebook, paperback, and audiobook. So these are the 4 books I self-published. And I deleted my phone number a long time ago from my puppy training website because I don't want people to call me randomly. Furthermore, I have more than 100,000 people visiting my website every single month, and that's only my website. Besides my website, I also have social media channels. It means that if one of those 100,000 people thinks my website stinks, there are 99,999 people left that do visit my website. Me and my family's future isn't reliant on one single person or one single company. And don't get me wrong, I understand that the client in the story I just shared probably would have generated many more dollars than one of my clients. The question is, would you rather have 2 clients paying you $50,000 each per year or 100,000 clients paying you $1 per year? For me, I'd rather have those 100,000 customers instead of 2, because the result is not having to rely on one single customer for your livelihood. Furthermore, the online business I built never needed many capital injections from the start. The beauty of building an online business where you build an audience first is that it only costs you time and energy, only a few bucks to create a website. So not a 30,000 euro loss that the guy had in the story I shared. So last year in 2020, I made $271,792 in revenue after VAT. And 95% of this number came from me selling my 4 self-published books. In other words, I made $259,463 from selling my 4 self-published books about puppy training. The beautiful thing about having a blog, social media channel, and products you're selling is that it's just a math equation. After a while, you know how much percent of your total visitors buy your products. I expect around 100,000 people to visit my website every month on average. And therefore, I can calculate an expected revenue number for the upcoming months. These days, I only spend around 1 to 3 hours per week or so on my puppy training business. And this business is making most of my revenue nowadays. How amazing is that? I find it honestly mind-blowing, and sometimes I still can't really comprehend how incredible the times are right now we're living in, with the internet giving us these many opportunities. While reading the story of the guy that screwed up his family vacation because, in my opinion, he chose the wrong business, I wrote down 5 lessons I learned from that story, combining it with my own experiences. So lesson number 1 is that you should not quit your 9-to-5 job if you don't have any income to fall back on, especially if you have responsibilities like a family you need to support. I built my puppy training business while working my 9-to-5 job as an internet marketing consultant for 2 years. After they laid me off, I chose the entrepreneurial path in 2017, and 1 year later, in 2018, it was the first time my creator income, so to speak, surpassed my living expenses for the first time. In other words, my puppy training business made me enough money to sustain my lifestyle. And I'm not sure about the guy in the example I just gave, but I believe he didn't have another job besides his business. Meaning, when his sole client cancelled, he had nothing to fall back on. So lesson number 2 is that you should have an emergency fund of 12 months. So by an emergency fund, I mean savings in a bank that can sustain your minimum lifestyle for the upcoming 12 months if you don't have any income coming in. For some people, 12 months might seem high, since many people advise a 3-to-6-month emergency fund. In my opinion, if you have a 12-month emergency fund, you have plenty of time to get your income back on track without sacrificing your personal life too much, meaning saying yes to every job you can get your hands on. If you have a family and want to be with your loved ones, you don't want to say yes to every opportunity that comes by. You want to say yes to the things you genuinely want to say yes to. For me, as of this moment, having 15,000 euros emergency fund will be sufficient. I live in a relatively cheap rental property with my girlfriend. We have a dog and 1 car, and that's it. As of this moment, I still have too much cash at hand. I'm working towards having less cash and having more money invested in various assets. So my current situation is 44% cash and 56% invested. So a little over 102,000 euros in cash and 132,000 euros invested. So I'm steadily switching to a higher position invested. I'm buying every single month, dollar cost averaging. Back in November last year, 83% of my total net worth was cash. So I'm steadily working towards that 15,000 euros or so in cash. So lesson number 3 is that you should focus on building a scalable online business instead of a non-scalable offline business. In the example, that guy focused on deploying IT personnel to other companies. First off, every new contract or client he gets probably needs a custom approach, meaning scalability is more complicated. If you want to scale such a business, you need to hire more salespeople to make more deals. And more hires equal more time managing all those hires and more overhead, since you'll have more people on your payroll. Such businesses often have less profit margin than software businesses or online education businesses, for instance. A perfect example is the story of the software company Basecamp. They built a lean and very profitable software company 22 years in the making. They also publish interesting reads over at their blog, signalvnoise.com. I've learned a lot from reading their blog posts, and if you agree on some parts with me while watching this video, you probably like their blog as well. Check it out. So lesson number 4 is that you should focus on building a business that doesn't cost you barely any money investment up front. The guy from the story screwed up his vacation with his family because if he didn't do any damage control on the cancellation of his first and only client, he would have lost more than the 30 grand he ends up losing. And yes, if there is no monetary investment for you to do up front, the short-term upside often is much lower as well. You can't expect to publish your first blog or a video a week ago and have money pouring in a week later. If you sell a service, as the guy did in the story, usually you will get paid immediately after delivering the service. Building an audience with a blog or on YouTube usually costs you a few years before generating a decent income from it. You need to consider the ups and downsides of the things. For me, the downside of investing a significant percentage of my net worth into something that can go sideways is too risky. I rather play the long game without too much riskiness. Once I have more money, I can invest in riskier opportunities when the play money is a much smaller percentage of my total net worth. That's why I purchased some Bitcoin in November last year. I only spent a small amount of my total net worth on Bitcoin, meaning if it were to go down, I wouldn't lose sleep over it. I definitely wouldn't screw up quality family time over it. So lesson number 5 is to remove doubt from your brain. Nowadays, the steps to building an audience online are easy by starting a blog, a YouTube channel, or using social media to build an audience. The only question is, how determined are you to keep pursuing the building part of the audience? I often had doubts about my puppy training project, whether it would succeed in some shape or form. I already spent a lot of time on the project, but I didn't know for sure if it would succeed. In hindsight, I genuinely believe that it was inevitable that I would reach some success because I kept building. It's the same thing YouTuber Ali Abdaal shared in one of his YouTube videos about starting and building an audience on YouTube. And I'm not sure about his exact wording, but I believe it was somewhere around the lines, when you publish 2 videos per week for 3 years, you will find success on YouTube. Every new blog post you write, every new video you publish, every new backlink to your blog you'll get is a new building block to the house of success you're building. Your online success is inevitable if you keep at it and learn from the things that work well and learn from the things that don't work well. Then there is lesson number 5, which is focus. It's the last lesson I want to share, but it's a crucial one, and I believe it's the reason why I succeeded with my puppy training business. So again, it's having focus. Let's say your goal is to redo your bathroom. It could use a new shower and toilet, etc. Everything is pretty outdated already. If you don't have focus, you probably won't succeed. What do I mean with not having focus? So if you don't have focus, you might lose motivation to finish the job. The reason you lost motivation can be anything, but let's say you're busy doing other things. You're busy working your 9-to-5 job, doing other things in the house, chilling, etc. After a few months of tearing down your existing bathroom, you still need to finish the new one. But instead of finishing your bathroom, you keep postponing it for whatever reason. Months or maybe even a year later, you still didn't finish, making your house pretty much unlivable, since you don't have a working bathroom. While this example might seem strange to you, the internet is full of example stories of husbands that don't finish their DIY projects. In other words, do-it-yourself projects. And I'm not sure this is a good metaphor for building a business, but I believe many people experience this problem: lack of focus. They focus on the wrong things and keep pursuing different ideas without a chance of quitting their 9-to-5 jobs. Before the year 2015, I had pretty much the same problem. I started my puppy training blog in 2011, already a long time ago. And I started that blog while being in college, and I worked on that blog every now and then. I wasn't 100% focused on that blog, and I also had dozens of other projects I liked to spend my time on. I pursued so many different projects, like news-related websites, movie websites, and so forth. It might even be possible that I didn't spend any time on the puppy training blog for an entire year, because I worked on other things. The moment I started working my 9-to-5 job in 2015, I had less time on my hands, which made the difference for me. Because I had less time, I chose to put all my eggs in one basket, and that basket for me was my puppy training blog. So that focus resulted in me interviewing 30 dog experts, writing my 4 self-published books, improving the quality of my blog posts, building backlinks to my website, making YouTube videos, and so forth. 2018 was the first year ever one of my projects, my puppy training blog in this case, surpassed my living expenses. In 2019, the business grew even further, and last year in 2020, I made $271,792 in revenue after VAT. And 95% of this number came from me selling my 4 self-published books. And I think I'll leave it at that. Hopefully this video gave you an idea of my thought process on good and bad business ideas. And of course, these are my thoughts, and I know for a fact that lots of people will disagree with me. Not everyone believes that building an audience online, creating products online, and selling them online is the best career path. Heck, I even try to convince my girlfriend, but I simply can't. First off, she doesn't want to work from home all day, every day like I do. Furthermore, she simply doesn't feel like starting her own business, which is okay. But to be honest, it's still hard for me to comprehend why she doesn't want the same lifestyle as me, since for me, it looks like the best life a man can get. And it's not only my girlfriend who doesn't want to trade seats with me. One of my friends I recently asked why he doesn't start his own online business couldn't give me a clear answer to the question. He works like 50 to 60 hours per week for good money, but I don't get why he wouldn't start an online business. If he can make that same paycheck working fewer hours while doing the same thing he's interested in. It's probably me that I don't fully get it. And furthermore, it's probably a good thing that not everyone feels the same way like I do, else we would have had much more competition besides the fact that we need working people in all kinds of different industries in the world. Not only in online businesses selling software, information or entertainment. Anyhow, let me know in the comments how you think about this. What are your thoughts on the story I shared at the beginning of this video? Do you think it's a terrible business idea as well? Do you share similar thoughts I have about the balance between spending time with your family and work? Let me know in the comments below. Hopefully, I'll see you in the next video. Bye bye.